She single-handedly changed the way we talk about sex, not only in this country, but around the globe. With over 30 books, hundreds of hours of television shows, and radio programs that kept us listening way past our bedtimes, she helped move the sexual conversation beyond its taboo. But that's only part of the story. She's a Holocaust survivor, a freedom fighter, a documentary producer, and even a frequent guest on PBS's Between the Lions. Hello, I'm Ernie Manous. Coming up on Interviews, our conversation with best-selling author, grandmother, and world-renowned sex therapist, Dr. Ruth Westheimer. Are we so worried about talking about sex?
We're not so worried anymore. Look at me. I talk about sex from morning till night. But there is no question that the reluctance to talk about issues of sexuality is, to some extent, I'm actually welcoming it. Because I don't want people to walk around and ask each other, how is your sex life? I would like to have that topic discussed at the university, in books, on television, but in a little bit of a respect. So look, we come from a background where the Victorian Puritan mother told her daughter at the night of the wedding, lie back and think of England. So that Puritan Victorian attitude certainly, to some extent, is with us. But I think that people have to realize that I'm old-fashioned and a square. I speak very explicitly. I am very well-trained. I feel I can talk explicitly, but I also want to keep that kind of measure of respect for this very intimate activity. So I don't go on that bandwagon of saying that maybe we are more uptight than the French or than any other country. Not so. We in this country have the best scientifically validated data about human sexual functioning that has ever been available. From Kinsey, Masters and Johnson, Dr. Helen Singer Kaplan, who trained me. I worked with her for 7 years at Cornell Medical School. So we have a lot of data. And we know what we are talking about. Mm-hmm. And we have to do more education. And that's where television comes in.
But people who think then that because you talk about these things in public, on television, on the radio, in your books, that you are somehow promiscuous or very liberal in that.
Nonsense.
That's wrong.
Maybe you think that, but that's nonsense. Because anybody who knows me, I'm doing this now for many, many years, they know very well how much I respect different religious values. That's how I can give a talk at very Catholic universities, that I take it very seriously. Nobody's going to think that this Dr. Ruth Westheimer, at the age of 78, a grandmother, is advocating go out and have sex. I can talk at a Republican breakfast. I can talk at Catholic universities. I'm now going to Utah to give a talk at a Mormon university. And that's exactly because I have set a certain standard. We have to do sex education, and I can prove to you that because we talk about it, because you and I sit and discuss it, there are less unintended pregnancies because people know about contraception. And I'm not talking only about pregnancies among young people. I'm talking about pregnancies. Anybody, even married people who don't want to be pregnant. And we do know that there is tremendous change. We know that there are less women who haven't heard the message, and I'm not the only one who talks about it, that a woman has to take the responsibility for her sexual satisfaction. She has to teach her partner what she needs in order to have an orgasm, in order to be satisfied. And that message is going across. And here my latest book is Dr. Ruth talks about sex to people over 50. They okay. used to think that over 50, why do they have to have sex? They're not wanting to have children. They are not really attractive in the way the American television and Hollywood says who is attractive. And I did a book, and it's it just won an award. It won a silver award, saying even people over 50 have to learn certain aspects of sexuality.
When you talk about it in people over 50, when you talk about it in anyone, are we talking more about sex or intimacy, and how do you separate
I talk
them?
Specifically about sex. No question that intimacy is part of it. But I talk specifically about the issues that men and women have to know, that over 50, that a woman after menopause needs to use a lubricant so that she doesn't have pain during intercourse, mm-hmm. that a man at a certain age, and I'm not giving it an age, but I think about maybe over 50 needs, doesn't have what is called a psychogenic erection. He needs physical stimulation in order to obtain and maintain the erection. And many couples don't know that. That's one of the reasons that I'm delighted to work with gynecologists, because mm-hmm. they will talk about the issues that men and women have to know. That's why I work with the urologists, because when a man cannot have an erection, and if he cannot use any of these fantastic pharmaceutical pills, I say you have to go to see a urologist, because there are other ways available.
Right.
There are other ways of erectile restoration. Can you say that?
Erectile restoration.
Okay.
There you go.
Almost my accent. So, you see, I will talk at Notre Dame University exactly the way I talk with you. And that makes that very strong stand that there is nothing wrong if you do it with the respect for intimacy. Because here's what you were saying before about intimacy. My course at Yale, I'm now teaching one semester Yale University, a seminar, one semester Princeton, a seminar, and this coming semester I'm even going for a day to Harvard. So at Yale, the course is actually called The American Family, Issues of Intimacy. And there we mean intimacy and sexuality. Huh. At Princeton, it's the issues of the Jewish family.
Take me back, though. When you started all of this, was it ever uncomfortable? Were you ever ill at ease to talk about these things? Or when you started off, could you go right into this full...
No. Course? I, first of all, was very fortunate. I already had my doctorate in the interdisciplinary study of the family. I already had worked for 3 years at Planned Parenthood, where people talk about sex from morning till night. Then I was very fortunate, 7 years at the Cornell Medical School, being trained by a wonderful trainer, Dr. Helen Singer Kaplan, who had, she's not alive anymore, a PhD in psychology and an MD. So she was a psychiatrist and a psychologist. When I started on radio, and then later I did 450 television programs, I sometimes had to say to myself, Ruth Westheimer, look what you're doing, look how you are talking. And I'm not even saying that I didn't blush sometimes with some of the questions I got. Right. I still blush sometimes. That's okay. Because I don't, it's not a topic that is like a diet or a topic that's like bicycle riding. It is a topic that is crucial, important, and still has to be flanked by that kind of intimacy that two people have when they get engaged in sex.
Yeah. When you see parodies of yourself, when you see jokes made of you, how do you perceive that?
I ignore it. Next question.
Really? Okay.
Next question.
All right. Take me
because
back.
Because I'm very fortunate. From Johnny Carson, where I was on Johnny Carson's show, and when I told Johnny Carson that he is responsible for Americans having problems in the bedroom, Johnny Carson said to me, me? How come? I said, they stay up, they watch you, and then they are too tired and they can't have sex. So you are responsible. From that day on, he was a wonderful, wonderful promoter of mine. Right. I was on David Letterman maybe 15 times, more frequent than his many other people at the time. And then I was on Arsenio Hall, more often than his best friend, Eddie Murphy. So if some place, if somebody does make fun, I shrug my shoulders and I walk away. Right. I don't get mad, but I'm very fortunate. I have very little of that.
Yeah. Take me all the way back to the beginning, though. Mm-hmm. And you grew up in Germany.
I grew up in Frankfurt, and I left at the age of 10. I was sent with a group of children just at the start, just before World War II, January 5th of 1939, to children's home in Switzerland, hoping that my parents and family would be able to leave. They could not leave. And I stayed in that children's home for 6 years, and then went to then, in 1945, my parents never got out of Germany.
Before you went to the children's home, before you went up to Switzerland, do you remember your father being, if I understand the story correctly, he was arrested first before you left?
Yes, but I don't want to talk about that.
Okay.
Because I tell you why. I have done biography, it's done. I have done CBS 60 Minutes, not 60 Minutes only, CBS This Morning, and talked about that. So I'll tell you that in a nutshell, what I did, but I'm not interested in doing the story of my life. I've done that. And this is not something that I mix up when I talk about relationship and when I talk about how important it is for people to have a significant other. So I'm keeping that very much aside. But I, in a nutshell, can tell you that in 1945, right after the war, I went to then Palestine. And you better be careful, because I was a sniper in the Haganah.
I was going to ask about
that. In the underground, and I was a real good sniper. I can still put 5 bullets into the red circle for people who ask me questions that I don't want to be asked. So I never killed anybody, but I was badly wounded. And some people next to me in a young girl's residence were killed. And I badly wounded him from a shrapnel of a cannonball, both my legs. But there was a wonderful surgeon. I can ski. I still ski. And I can dance. 2 nights ago, I danced for 3 hours at a at a party. And then I went to Paris and was fortunate to study psychology at the Sorbonne. Very rigorous study.
Can I ask then, without being specific, all of those events before, do you think that led you into psychology and all the work that you've done since?
No question. That's a very good question. People like myself who have survived World War II and became orphans like me have an obligation to do something to give back to society. Because otherwise, why would I have survived and so many others did not? So many of us, I'm not the only one, went into the helping profession. Nobody else became Dr. Ruth, but many became social workers, nurses, kindergarten teachers, in order to be in the helping profession. So there's no question that people coming out from such a traumatic experience have that strong commitment to do something for the world. I didn't know then that I would talk about sex all day long. But I did know that there would be something that I would do to make it better. So what's very important to know about myself and people like me is that to make, in Hebrew there is a term that means to help to repair the world. And it doesn't matter in which area you do that. Some people go to the Peace Corps. Some people do some other things. And that was certainly a strong motivation in my going to the helping profession.
Mm-hmm. When you look at what you then did after that, you started in teaching, as I understand, and then you went into all of the rest of this. Do you ever wonder if you had stayed a teacher, how different your life would have been?
Well, if I had stayed in Israel, I would have been a supervisor of teachers. I would not have had the opportunity to have an academic career because I don't have a high school diploma. But don't tell anybody. I have already now three, actually four, honorary doctorates. But so I would have been a supervisor of kindergarten teachers, and who knows what would have happened. I have a very strong feeling of thankfulness of being in this country. I go to Israel every single year. I'll tell you in a moment about a documentary for PBS. That's my third documentary for PBS that I did. But I'm delighted to live here. There's no question. What has happened to me could have only happened in the United States with these opportunities and only coming out of New York, because you hear my accent. Right. And but it's fun to walk on Westheimer in Houston and everybody knows me.
You have your own street in Houston.
I have my own street. It has nothing to do with me. But my late husband, who passed away a few years ago, he was very happy with Houston that there is a Westheimer road. And today I signed books at Barnes & Noble, not only my latest book, but some others, like Sex for Dummies. And the Barnes & Noble is on Westheimer.
So there it goes again. When you look back at the books, and there have been over 30 now that you've written, are there ones you would go back and change what's in it, or pretty much as each book came along, it was right for the moment?
It was absolutely right for the moment. I did my autobiography, some of the questions that you asked me, which is still on the market. It's called All in a Lifetime. I did a book just 2 years ago, University of Pennsylvania Press, called Musically Speaking, A Life Through Song. So I'm talking a little bit about the sadness of my life, but also what music did in order to overcome that. And then the best seller, 32 languages, is Sex for Dummies. I didn't want to do that. I said, I don't write for dummies. I talk to intelligent television interviewers. So I went to a store, looked at Windows for Dummies, and I said, hold it, I'll do that. So as we speak, this month, the third edition of Sex for Dummies is coming out, which is fabulous because it really shows the interest. Because when I say sex, it's not just sex, it's relationship, it's all the other things that we talked about. And here the third edition is coming out.
When you look back on the career that you've had in this field, you look at the way people are today, have they figured it out? Have they learned? Or are we still struggling the same things when you
started?
That's
a very good question. The questions that I get on television, on radio, wherever I talk, in the lectures. At the last lecture upstate New York in Oneonta, New York State College, and also at Cornell. At Cornell there were 900 students, at Oneonta, 1,200. So you could say, hey, what's the matter here? How come they don't know it yet?
Yeah.
First of all, I have a way of presenting it that's fun. And the other point is the questions people have, questions about loneliness, questions about how to find a partner, questions about boredom. Like in my latest book, Over 50, the important sentence there is kick boredom out of your bedroom. So the questions are the same. I tell you what has changed. The vocabulary. People don't talk anymore about a pregnant woman. She is with child. They say a pregnant woman.
Right.
So the vocabulary has changed. It has something to do with the internet. It has something to do with programs like Sex in the City. But people have to know that this is television. Sex in the City, I have nothing against the dialogue. I myself watch it from time to time. But it's television. It's Hollywood.
Right.
It's not realistic. There are no 20 men waiting for each woman in New York City to whisk her to Paris and get a mink coat. So that's where it's so important to continue talking about this.
Well, let me ask you, you bring up Sex and the City, you bring up Hollywood, and it makes me think everything from advertising down through television into even pornography. There's images of the way people should look and the attractiveness and all of that. Does that hurt us as a society when we're stuck with real people trying to figure our way out of a real situation.
Yeah, no question. Pornography for me is only when it involves violence or children. The other films that are sexually explicit, I have no problem. However, you're absolutely right. If they always portray these slim, well-dressed hunks and women, and then women look in the mirror and say, I don't look like this, it could give a message by saying you can't have good sex. But that's why you and I have to talk about this. That the image that people project and the reality of life is not what we see on television in Hollywood.
Can they make realistic films that show real relationships, or have we as a culture so turned our back on what is real to what is fantasy that it wouldn't work?
That's a good question. And I don't think they could make a movie of very heavy people. I hear that Houston has a problem with that. I don't think so. Yeah. I think that people would not watch it. But people have, I don't care if they watch The Beautiful People, in quote, but they have to realize that this is not reality. And I'm not saying that they should, I'm on no bandwagon and saying they should show different people, except there was maybe 15 years ago was a movie that showed, and I showed it in many classrooms, that showed two older people making love. And first people were shocked because they were not good looking, they didn't have all their, he didn't have all his hair, but that was a tender, loving movie of giving that message that people of different body build, and the same is true of homosexual movies, of making sure that to show that the relationship is the important one, mm-hmm. not just the sex act.
So then how do we break that down? How do we get people to relate to each other in a real way?
First of all, by talking, like we mm-hmm. are doing right now, and by saying there has to be this deep feeling of how fortunate I have another person in my life. Most people, I'm not saying everybody, most people want to have a significant other, mm-hmm. a person that they can relate to. And that's what we have to say. We have to say, nobody's going to bring you a lover on a silver platter into your living room. You have to be out there, do something, participate in activities, do something that's of interest to you, and you will find somebody who is interested in that. I don't care if it's skiing, if it's bicycle riding, if it's bowling, or if it is charity work. Mm-hmm. If people participate in some fundraiser for cancer, for example, they will find other people who have that same passion, who are in that same way of saying, I'm doing something for society.
You are definitely at the point in your career where you could retire. You could take a break from it. Yet you don't.
God forbid. First of all,
God forbid.
That term retire doesn't exist for me. Sherry Lansing, the who had a studio head, she coined a terrific term. I didn't coin it, but I use it every day. Instead of retire, rewire. Now, I'm not saying everybody has to continue what they were doing. Maybe they want to do something else. Maybe they want to volunteer at a hospital, but they have to do something. So that word retire on your PBS station has to be buried. It has to be said, do something else with your life. And there is no question. If I would be bored with that topic of intimacy and family life and sexuality, I would do something else. Here's the point. I have now done my fourth, and I'm telling you particularly about this one. I go to Israel every year. I speak Hebrew fluently. I did a wonderful, high ratings in New York, documentary on the family life of the Druze. I do these documentaries for PBS. So you know, nobody better than you, that this is not for money. I raise the money. And I promise everybody good sex who gives me money. I have a new project next summer, The Family Life of the Bedouin. But you see, I create an interest in something that I'm passionate about. So I did that last year. It was already shown in New York. Wonderful ratings. And what it shows is the importance of childhood education. Because these Druze men serve in the army. They are very good looking. But they cannot marry no Israeli, no Christian, no Muslim. They have to go back and marry only somebody within that Druze sect, which is very interesting.
Do you think ultimately that's a good idea?
It's debatable, because then you could say, because if he marries, that's a good point, if he marries a woman that he met in the army, let's say, he cannot remain a Druze. So I'm not a prophet to know what will happen in the far future, but I can say, let's look at the example, how they raise their children, that from early childhood they know that they have to marry a Druze.
Yeah. And I am finding out that we are out of time, and I can't thank you enough for sitting down and talking with us today.
Thank you.
Dr. Ruth.
And good luck to you.
Thank you.
Transcript, call 866-652-3378 or send $6.95 to the address on your screen. Please include the name of the guest.